This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. President of the United States First Term Campaign for the Presidency 1981, Inauguration Presidency Reaganomics Attempted Assassination Reagan Doctrine Cold War Domestic Policy Second Term Landslide Re-election 1984 Second, Inauguration Foreign Policy Iran-Contra Affair Cold War INF Treaty Tear Down This Wall, Bombing of Libya Challenger Disaster Presidential Library Legacy Post-Presidency and American Life Alzheimer's State Funeral V.E. Ronald Wilson Reagan, RNL Dwellesen Ren, February 6, 1911. After moving to Hollywood in 1937, he became an actor and starred in a few major productions. Reagan was twice elected president of the Screen Actors Guild, the labor union for actors, where he worked to root out communist influence in the 1950s. He moved into television and was a motivational speaker at General Electric factories. Having been a lifelong Democrat, his views changed. He became a conservative and in 1962 switched to the Republican Party. In 1964, Reagan's speech, A Time for Choosing, in support of Barry Goldwater's floundering presidential campaign, earned him national attention as a new conservative spokesman building a network of supporters. He was elected governor of California in 1966 as governor. Reagan raised taxes, turned a state budget deficit to a surplus, challenged the protesters at the University of California, ordered National Guard troops in during a period of protest movements in 1969, and was re-elected in 1970. He twice ran unsuccessfully for the Republican nomination for the U.S. presidency in 1968 and 1976. 4 years later, he easily won the nomination outright, going on to be elected the second oldest president, defeating incumbent Jimmy Carter in 1980. Entering the presidency in 1981, Reagan implemented sweeping new political and economic initiatives. His supply-side economic policies, dubbed Reaganomics, advocated tax rate reduction to spur economic growth, control of the money supply to curb inflation, economic deregulation, and reduction in government spending. In his first term, he survived an assassination attempt, spurred the war on drugs, and fought public sector labor over his two terms. His economic policies saw a reduction of inflation from 125% to 44%, and an average annual growth of real GDP of 34%, a third of what Franklin D. Roosevelt had achieved. While Reagan did enact cuts in domestic discretionary spending, increased military spending contributed to increased federal outlays overall. Even after adjustment for inflation during his re-election bid, Reagan campaigned on the notion that it was morning in America, winning a landslide in 1984 with the largest electoral college victory in history. Foreign affairs dominated his second term, including ending of the Cold War, the bombing of Libya, and the Iran-Contra affair, publicly describing the Soviet Union as an evil empire. He transitioned Cold War policy from détente to rollback, by escalating an arms race with the USSR while engaging in talks with Soviet General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev, which culminated in the INF Treaty, shrinking both countries' nuclear arsenals. During his famous speech at the Brandenburg Gate, President Reagan challenged Gorbachev to tear down this wall. 5 months after the end of his term, the Berlin Wall fell, and on December 26, 1991, nearly 3 years after he left office, the Soviet Union collapsed. Leaving office in 1989, Reagan held an approval rating of 68%, matching those of Franklin D. Roosevelt, and later Bill Clinton, as the highest ratings for departing presidents in the modern era. He was the first president since Dwight D. Eisenhower to serve two full terms, after a succession of five prior presidents failed to do so while having planned an active post-presidency. In 1994, Reagan disclosed his diagnosis with Alzheimer's disease earlier that year, appearing publicly for the last time at the funeral of Richard Nixon. He died 10 years later in 2004 at the age of 93, an icon among Republicans. He is viewed favorably in historian rankings of U.S. presidents, and his tenure constituted a realignment toward conservative policies in the United States. Contents 1. Early life 2. Entertainment career 21. Radio and film 22. Military service 23. SAG presidency 231. Secret FBI informant in Hollywood 24. Television 3. Marriages and children 4. Early political career 5. Governorship of California 1967-1975-6 1976 presidential campaign 7. 1980 presidential campaign 8 Presidency of the United States, 1981-1989-81 First Term 811 Prayer in Schools and a Moment of Silence 812 Assassination Attempt 813 Assistant Secretary of State Nomination 814 Air Traffic Controllers Strike 815 Reaganomics and the Economy 816 Escalation of the Cold War 817 Lebanese Civil War 818 Operation Urgent Fury Grenada 819-1984 Presidential Campaign 82 Second Term 821 War on Drugs 822 Response to AIDS Epidemic 823 Libya Bombing 824 Immigration 825 Iran-Contra Affair 826 End of the Cold War 83 Health 84 Judiciary 9 Post-Presidency, 1989-2004-91 Public Speaking 92 Assault 93 Alzheimer's Disease 931 Announcement and Reaction, 1994-932 Progression, 1994-2004-10 Death 11 Legacy 111 Cold War 112 Domestic and Political Legacy 113 Cultural and Political Image 114 Honors 12 See also 13 References 14 Sources 15 Further Reading 151 Primary Sources 152 Historiography 16 External Links 161 Official Sites 162 Media 163 News Coverage 164 Essays and Historiographies 165 Other Early Life Reagan with Dutch Haircut, Older Brother Neil, and Parents Jack and Nell, see 1916-17 As a teenager in the 1920s Dixon, Illinois Ronald Wilson Reagan was born in an apartment on the second floor of a commercial building in Tampico, Illinois on February 6, 1911, the son of Nell Clyde Wilson and John Edward Jack. Reagan Reagan's father was a salesman and a storyteller, the grandson of Irish Catholic immigrants from County Tipperary, while his mother was of half Scots and half English descent. Reagan's maternal grandmother was born in Surrey, England. Reagan had one older brother, Neil 1908-1996, who became an advertising executive as a boy. Reagan's father nicknamed his son Dutch due to his fat little Dutchman-like appearance, and his Dutch boy. Haircut, the nickname stuck with him throughout his youth. Reagan's family briefly lived in several towns and cities in Illinois, including Monmouth, Galesburg, and Chicago in 1919. They returned to Tampico and lived above the H.C. Pitney Variety Store until finally settling in Dixon after his election as president, residing in the upstairs White House private quarters. Reagan would quip that he was living above the store again. According to Paul Kenger, author of God and Ronald Reagan, Reagan had a particularly strong faith in the goodness of people, which stemmed from the optimistic faith of his mother, Nell, and the Disciples of Christ faith, which he was baptized into in 1922 for the time. Reagan was unusual in his opposition to racial discrimination, and recalled a time in Dixon when the local inn would not allow black people to stay there. Reagan brought them back to his house, where his mother invited them to stay the night and have breakfast the next morning after the closure of the Pitney store. In late 1920, the Reagans moved to Dixon. The Midwestern small universe had a lasting impression on Reagan. He attended Dixon High School, where he developed interests in acting, sports, and storytelling. His first job was as a lifeguard at the Rock River in Lowell Park, near Dixon. In 1927, over a six-year period, Reagan reportedly performed 77 rescues as a lifeguard. Reagan attended Eureka College, a disciples-oriented liberal arts school, where he became a member of the Tau Kappa Epsilon fraternity, a cheerleader, and studied economics and sociology while involved. The Miller Center of Public Affairs described him as an indifferent student. He majored in economics and graduated with a C average. He developed a reputation as a jack of all trades, excelling in campus politics, sports, and theater. He was a member of the football team and captain of the swim team. He was elected student body president and led a student revolt against the college president after he tried to cut back the faculty entertainment career. Further information: Ronald Reagan filmography, radio and film. The Bad Man 1941. After graduating from Eureka in 1932, Reagan drove himself to Iowa, where he held jobs as an announcer at several stations. He moved to WHO Radio in Des Moines as an announcer for Chicago Cubs baseball games. His specialty was creating play-by-play accounts of games, using as his source only basic descriptions that the station received by wire as the games were in progress. While traveling with the Cubs in California, Reagan took a screen test in 1937 that led to a seven-year contract with Warner Brothers Studios. He spent the first few years of his Hollywood career in the B-film unit, where, Reagan joked, the producers didn't want them. Good, they wanted them Thursday. Play Media Kings Row 1942 gave a brief boost to Reagan's career. His first screen credit was the starring role in the 1937 movie Love Is on the Air, and by the end of 1939 he had already appeared in 19 films, including Dark Victory with Bette Davis and Humphrey Bogart before the film Santa Fe Trail with Errol Flynn in 1940. He played the role of George, the Gipper. Gip in the film Newt Rockne, All-American. From it, he acquired the lifelong nickname, the Gipper. In 1941, exhibitors voted him the fifth most popular star from the younger generation in Hollywood. Reagan's favorite acting role was as a double amputee in 1942's King's Row, in which he recites the line, "Where's the rest of me?" later used as the title of his 1965 autobiography. Many film critics considered King's Row to be his best movie, though the film was condemned by New York Times critic Bosley Crowther. Although Reagan called King's Row the film that made me a star, he was unable to capitalize on his success because he was ordered to active duty with the U.S. Army at San Francisco 2 months after its release, and never regained star status in motion pictures in the post-war era. After being separated from almost 4 years of World War II stateside service with the 1st Motion Picture Unit in December 1945, Reagan co-starred in such films as The Voice of the Turtle, John Loves Mary, The Hasty Heart, Bedtime for Bonzo, Cattle Queen of Montana, Tennessee's Partner, Hellcats of the Navy, the only film in which he appears with Nancy Reagan, and the 1964 remake The Killers, his final film and the only one in which he played a villain throughout his film career. His mother answered much of his fan mail. Military service with wife Jane Wyman, 1942. After completing 14 home study Army extension courses, Reagan enlisted in the Army Enlisted Reserve and was commissioned a second lieutenant in the Officers' Reserve Corps of the Cavalry on May 25, 1937. Reagan was ordered to active duty for the first time on April 18, 1942 due to his poor eyesight. He was classified for limited service only, which excluded him from serving overseas. His first assignment was at the San Francisco Port of Embarkation at Fort Mason, California, as a liaison officer of the Port and Transportation Office. Upon the approval of the Army Air Force AAF, he applied for a transfer from the Cavalry to the AAF on May 15, 1942, and was assigned to AAF Public Relations and subsequently to the 1st Motion Picture Unit, officially the 18th Army Air Force Base Unit, in Culver City, California on January 14, 1943. He was promoted to First Lieutenant and was sent to the Provisional Task Force Show Unit. Of This Is the Army at Burbank, California. He returned to the 1st Motion Picture Unit after completing this duty and was promoted to Captain on July 22, 1943. Capt. Ronald Reagan at Fort Roach in January 1944. Reagan was ordered to temporary duty in New York City to participate in the opening of the 6th War Loan Drive. He was reassigned to the 1st Motion Picture Unit on November 14, 1944, where he remained until the end of World War II. He was recommended for promotion to Major on February 2, 1945, but this recommendation was disapproved on July 17 of that year. While with the 1st Motion Picture Unit in 1945, he was indirectly involved in discovering actress Marilyn Monroe. He returned to Fort MacArthur, California, where he was separated from active duty on December 9, 1945. By the end of the war, his units had produced some 400 training films for the AAF. Reagan never left the United States during the war, though he kept a film reel, obtained while in the service, depicting the liberation of Auschwitz, as he believed that someday doubts would arise as to whether the Holocaust had occurred. It has been alleged that he was overheard telling Israeli Foreign Minister Yitzhak Shamir in 1983 that he had filmed that footage himself and helped liberate Auschwitz, though this purported conversation was disputed by Secretary of State George P. Shultz. SAG presidency. Hosting General Electric Theater. Reagan was first elected to the board of directors of the Screen Actors Guild in 1941, serving as an alternate after World War II. He resumed service and became third vice president in 1946. The adoption of conflict of interest bylaws in 1947 led the SAG president and 6 board members to resign. Reagan was nominated in a special election for the position of president and subsequently elected. He was subsequently chosen by the membership to serve 7 additional 1-year 10-year terms, from 1947 to 1952, and in 1959 Reagan led the SAG through eventful years that were marked by labor management disputes, the Taft-Hartley Act, House Un-American Activities Committee HUAC hearings, and the Hollywood blacklist era secret FBI informant in Hollywood guest stars for the premiere of The Dick Powell Show. Reagan stands behind, at the far left of the photograph during the late 1940s, Reagan and his wife provided the FBI with names of actors within the motion picture industry whom they believed to be communist sympathizers, though he expressed reservations. He said, "Do they expect us to constitute ourselves as a little FBI of our own and determine just who is a commie and who isn't?" Reagan testified before the House Un-American Activities Committee on the subject as well a fervent anti-communist. He reaffirmed his commitment to democratic principles, stating, "I never as a citizen want to see our country become urged, by either fear or resentment of this group, that we ever compromise with any of our democratic principles through that fear or resentment." Television. Though an early critic of television, Reagan landed fewer film roles in the late 1950s and decided to join the medium. He was hired as the host of General Electric Theater, a series of weekly dramas that became very popular. His contract required him to tour GE plants 16 weeks out of the year, often demanding of him 14 speeches per day. He earned approximately $125,000 per year, about $107. Marriages and Children. Matron of Honor Brenda Marshall and Best Man William Holden, sole guests at the wedding of Ronald and Nancy Reagan, 1952. In 1938, Reagan co-starred in the film Brother Rat with actress Jane Wyman. 1917-2007, they were engaged at the Chicago Theater, and married on January 26, 1940, at the Wee Kirko the Heather Church in Glendale, California. Together they had two biological children, Maureen 1941-2001 and Christine, who was born in 1947 but only lived one day, and adopted a third, Michael, born 1945. After arguments about Reagan's political ambitions, Wyman filed for divorce in 1948, citing a distraction due to her husband's Screen Actors Guild union duties. The divorce was finalized in 1949. Wyman, who was a registered Republican, also stated that their breakup was due to a difference in politics. Ronald Reagan was still a Democrat at the time. He was the first U.S. president to have been divorced. Reagan and Wyman continued to be friends until his death, with Wyman voting for Reagan in both of his runs and, upon his death, saying, "America has lost a great president and a great, kind, and gentle man." Reagan met actress Nancy Davis 1921-2016. In 1949, after she contacted him in his capacity as president of the Screen Actors Guild to help her with issues regarding her name appearing on a communist blacklist in Hollywood, she had been mistaken for another Nancy Davis. She described their meeting by saying, "I don't know if it was exactly love at first sight, but it was pretty close." They were engaged at Chasen's restaurant in Los Angeles and were married on March 4, 1952, at the Little Brown Church in the Valley, North Hollywood, now Studio City. San Fernando Valley actor William Holden served as best man at the ceremony. They had two children, Patty, born October 21, 1952, and Ron, born May 20, 1958. Observers described the Reagan's relationship as close, authentic, and intimate. During his presidency, they were reported to frequently display their affection for one another. One press secretary said, "They never took each other for granted. They never stopped courting. He often called her Mommy and she called him Ronnie. He once wrote to her, 'Whatever I treasure and enjoy all would be without meaning if I didn't have you.'" When he was in the hospital in 1981, she slept with one of his shirts to be comforted by his scent. In a letter to U.S. citizens written in 1994, Reagan wrote, "I have recently been told that I am one of the millions of Americans who will be afflicted with Alzheimer's disease. I only wish there was some way I could spare Nancy from this painful experience." And in 1998, while Reagan was stricken by Alzheimer's, Nancy told Vanity Fair, "Our relationship is very special. We were very much in love and still are. When I say my life began with Ronnie, well, it's true it did. I can't imagine life without him." Nancy Reagan died on March 6, 2016 at the age of 94. Early political career. Ronald and Nancy Reagan aboard a boat in California, 1964. Reagan began as a Hollywood Democrat. Franklin D. Roosevelt was his great hero. He moved to the right in the 1950s, became a Republican in 1962, and emerged as a leading conservative spokesman in the Goldwater campaign of 1964. He joined numerous political committees with a left-wing orientation, such as the American Veterans Committee. He fought against Republican-sponsored right-to-work legislation and for Helen Monongahgan Douglas in 1950, when she was defeated for the Senate by Richard Nixon. It was his realization that communists were a powerful backstage influence in those groups that led him to rally his friends against them. Reagan spoke frequently at rallies with a strong ideological dimension. In December 1945, he was stopped from leading an anti-nuclear rally in Hollywood by pressure from the Warner Brothers studio. He would later make nuclear weapons a key point of his presidency, specifically his opposition to mutual assured destruction, building on previous efforts to limit the spread of nuclear weapons to a new focus to reduce the numbers and types of them. In the 1948 election, Reagan strongly supported Harry S. Truman, appearing on stage with him during a campaign speech in Los Angeles. However, in the early 1950s, as his relationship with actress Nancy Davis grew, he shifted to the right and endorsed the presidential candidacies of Dwight D. Eisenhower in 1952 and 1956, as well as Richard Nixon in 1960. He was hired by General Electric in 1954 to host the General Electric Theater, a weekly TV drama series. Much more importantly, he crisscrossed the country giving talks to over 200,000 GE employees as a motivational speaker. His many speeches, which he wrote himself, were nonpartisan but carried a conservative, pro-business message. He was influenced by Lemuel Boulware, a senior GE executive. Boulware, known for his tough stance against unions and his innovative strategies to win over workers, championed the core tenets of modern American conservatism: free markets, anti-communism, lower taxes, and limited government. Eager for a larger stage, but not allowed to enter politics by GE, he quit and formally registered as a Republican. He often said, "I didn't leave the Democratic Party, the party left me." When legislation that would become Medicare was introduced in 1961, Reagan created a recording for the American Medical Association warning that such legislation would mean the end of freedom in America. Reagan said that if his listeners did not write letters to prevent it, "We will awake to find that we have socialism, and if you don't do this, and if I don't do it, one of these days, you and I are going to spend our sunset years telling our children, and our children's children, what it once was like in America when men were free." He also joined the National Rifle Association and would become a lifetime member. Reagan gained national attention in his speeches for conservative presidential contender Barry Goldwater in 1964. Speaking for Goldwater, Reagan stressed his belief in the importance of smaller government, consolidating themes he had developed in talks for GE. He argued in A Time for Choosing, "The founding fathers knew a government can't control the economy without controlling people, and they knew when a government sets out to do that, it must use force and coercion to achieve its purpose. So we have come to a time for choosing." Governorship of California, 1967-1975. Main article, Governorship of Ronald Reagan. See also, Electoral History of Ronald Reagan. Section. Convention. Nixon had 692 delegate votes, 25 more than he needed to secure the nomination, followed by Rockefeller with Reagan in third place. Reagan was involved in high-profile conflicts with the protest movements of the era. On May 15, 1969, during the People's Park protests at UC Berkeley, Reagan sent the California Highway Patrol and other officers to quell the protests, in an incident that became known as Bloody Thursday, resulting in the death of student James Rector and the blinding of carpenter Alan Blanchard. Reagan then called out 2,200 state National Guard troops to occupy the city of Berkeley for 2 weeks to crack down on the protesters. A year after Bloody Thursday, Reagan responded to questions about campus protest movements saying, "If it takes a bloodbath, let's get it over with, no more appeasement." When the Symbionese Liberation Army kidnapped Patty Hearst in Berkeley and demanded the distribution of food to the poor, Reagan joked to a group of political aides about a botulism outbreak contaminating the food. Conversely, in that one afternoon, Bloody Thursday, 111 police officers were injured, including one CHP officer who was knifed in the chest after calling in the National Guard. The Guard remained in Berkeley for 17 days, camping in People's Park, and demonstrations subsided as the university removed cordoned off fencing and placed all development plans for People's Park on hold. Meeting with President Richard Nixon and First Lady Pat Nixon, July 1970. Early in 1967, the national debate on abortion was beginning. Democratic California State Senator Anthony C. Bilenson introduced the Therapeutic Abortion Act, in an effort to reduce the number of back-room abortions performed in California. The state legislature sent the bill to Reagan's desk where, after many days of indecision, he signed it. About 2 million abortions would be performed as a result, most because of a provision in the bill allowing abortions for the well-being of the mother. Reagan had been in office for only 4 months when he signed the bill, and later stated that had he been more experienced as governor, he would not have signed it after he recognized what he called the consequences of the bill. He announced that he was pro-life. He maintained that position later in his political career, writing extensively about abortion in 1967. Reagan signed the Mulford Act, which became California Penal Code 12031 and 171c. The bill repealed a law allowing public carrying of loaded firearms named after Republican Assemblyman Don Mulford. The bill garnered national attention after the Black Panthers marched bearing arms upon the California state capitol to protest the bill despite an unsuccessful attempt to recall him in 1968. Reagan was re-elected in 1970, defeating Big Daddy Jesse M. Unruh. He chose not to seek a third term in the following election cycle. One of Reagan's greatest frustrations in office concerned capital punishment, which he strongly supported. His efforts to enforce the state's laws in this area were thwarted when the Supreme Court of California issued its People v. Anderson decision, which invalidated all death sentences issued in California before 1972, though the decision was later overturned by a constitutional amendment. The only execution during Reagan's governorship was on April 12, 1967, when Aaron Mitchell's sentence was carried out by the state in San Quentin's gas chamber in 1969. Reagan, as governor, signed the Family Law Act, an amalgam of two bills which had been written and revised by the California state legislature for over 2 years and became the first no-fault divorce legislation in the United States. Reagan's terms as governor helped to shape the policies he would pursue in his later political career as president by campaigning on a platform of sending the welfare bums back to work. He spoke out against the idea of the welfare state. He also strongly advocated the Republican ideal of less government regulation of the economy, including that of undue federal taxation. Reagan did not seek re-election to a third term as governor in 1974 and was succeeded by the Secretary of State, Democrat Jerry Brown. On January 6, 1975, 1976 presidential campaign main article, Republican Party presidential primaries, 1976. See also, Electoral History of Ronald Reagan section. On the podium with Gerald Ford after narrowly losing the presidential nomination at the 1976 Republican National Convention. In 1976, Reagan challenged incumbent President Gerald Ford in a bid to become the Republican Party's candidate for president. Reagan soon established himself as the conservative candidate with the support of like-minded organizations such as the American Conservative Union, which became key components of his political base. While President Ford was considered a more moderate Republican, Reagan's campaign relied on a strategy crafted by campaign manager John Sears of winning a few primaries early to damage the inevitability of Ford's likely nomination. Reagan won North Carolina, Texas, and California, but the strategy failed, as he ended up losing New Hampshire, Florida, and his native Illinois. The Texas campaign lent renewed hope to Reagan, when he swept all 96 delegates chosen in the May 1 primary, with four more awaiting at the state convention. Much of the credit for that victory came from the work of three co-chairmen, including Ernest Angelo, the mayor of Midland, and Ray Barnhart of Houston, whom Reagan as president would appoint in 1981 as director of the Federal Highway Administration. However, as the GOP convention neared, Ford appeared close to victory. Acknowledging his party's moderate wing, Reagan chose moderate Senator Richard Schweiker of Pennsylvania as his running mate. If nominated nonetheless, Ford prevailed with 1,187 delegates to Reagan's 1,070. Ford would go on to lose the 1976 presidential election to the Democrat Jimmy Carter. Reagan's concession speech emphasized the dangers of nuclear war and the threat posed by the Soviet Union. Though he lost the nomination, he received 307 write-in votes in New Hampshire, 388 votes as an independent on Wyoming's ballot, and a single electoral vote from a faithless elector in the November election from the state of Washington, which Ford had won over Democratic challenger Jimmy Carter. After the campaign, Reagan remained in the public debate with the Ronald Reagan radio commentary series and his political action committee, Citizens for the Republic, which was later revived in Alexandria, Virginia, in 2009 by the Reagan biographer Craig Shirley. 1980 presidential campaign main articles, Ronald Reagan presidential campaign, 1980 and United States presidential election, 1980. See also, Electoral History of Ronald Reagan section. Some of his fundamental principles: lower taxes to stimulate the economy, less government interference in people's lives, states' rights, and a strong national defense. Reagan launched his campaign by declaring, "I believe in states' rights." After receiving the Republican nomination, Reagan selected one of his primary opponents, George H.W. Bush, to be his running mate. His showing in the October televised debate boosted his campaign. Reagan won the election, carrying 44 states with 489 electoral votes to 49 electoral votes for Carter, representing 6 states and Washington, D.C. Reagan received 51% of the popular vote while Carter took 41%. An independent John B. Anderson, a liberal Republican, received 7%. Republicans captured the Senate for the first time since 1952, and gained 34 House seats, but the Democrats retained a majority presidency of the United States. 1981-1989 Main article, Presidency of Ronald Reagan. Further information, domestic policy of the Ronald Reagan administration, foreign policy of the Ronald Reagan administration, and Reagan Doctrine. Inaugural parade January 20, 1981, as Reagan read his inaugural address, 52 U.S. hostages held by Iran for 444 days were set free during his presidency. Reagan pursued policies that reflected his personal belief in individual freedom, brought changes domestically, both to the U.S. economy and expanded military, and contributed to the end of the Cold War termed the Reagan Revolution. His presidency would reinvigorate American morale, reinvigorate the American economy, and reduce American reliance upon government. As president, Reagan kept a diary in which he commented on daily occurrences of his presidency and his views on the issues of the day. The diaries were published in May 2007 in the best-selling book, The Reagan Diaries. First term at the time, Reagan was the oldest person elected to the office of the presidency at 69 and the oldest president at the time of inauguration, at 69 years, 341 days. Donald Trump surpassed this record when elected at age 70 in his first inaugural address on January 20, 1981, which Reagan himself wrote. He addressed the country's economic malaise, arguing, "In this present crisis, government is not the solution to our problems. Government is the problem." Prayer in schools and a moment of silence in 1981, Reagan became the first president to propose a constitutional amendment on school prayer. Reagan's election reflected an opposition to the 1962 Supreme Court case Engle v. Vitale, prohibiting state officials from composing an official state prayer and requiring that it be recited in the public schools. Reagan's 1981 proposed amendment stated, "Nothing in this constitution shall be construed to prohibit individual or group prayer in public schools or other public institutions. No person shall be required by the United States or by any state to participate in prayer." In 1984, Reagan again raised the issue, asking Congress, "Why can't freedom to acknowledge God be enjoyed again by children in every schoolroom across this land?" In 1985, Reagan expressed his disappointment that the Supreme Court ruling still bans a moment of silence for public schools, and said he had an uphill battle. In 1987, Reagan again renewed his call for Congress to support voluntary prayer in schools and end the expulsion of God from America's classrooms. Critics argue that any governmental imposition of prayer on public school students is involuntary. No Supreme Court rulings suggest that students cannot engage in silent prayer on their own. During his term in office, Reagan campaigned vigorously to restore organized prayer to the schools, first as a moment of prayer and later as a moment of silence. Assassination attempt. Main article, attempt assassination of Ronald Reagan on March 30, 1981, only 69 days into the new administration. Reagan, his press secretary James Brady, Washington police officer Thomas Delahunty, and Secret Service agent Tim McCarthy were struck by gunfire from would-be assassin John Hinckley Jr., outside the Washington Hilton Hotel. Although close to death, upon arrival at George Washington University Hospital, Reagan was stabilized in the emergency room, then underwent emergency exploratory surgery. He recovered and was released from the hospital on April 11, becoming the first serving U.S. president to survive being shot in an assassination attempt. The attempt had great influence on Reagan's popularity. Polls indicated his approval rating to be around 73%. Reagan believed that God had spared his life so that he might go on to fulfill a greater purpose. Assistant Secretary of State nomination. In response to conservative criticism that the State Department lacked hardliners, Reagan in 1981 nominated Ernest W. LaFevre Lefevre as Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs. Lefevre performed poorly at his confirmation hearings and the Senate committee rejected his nomination by vote of 4-13. Lefevre withdrew his name. Air traffic controllers strike in summer 1981. PATCO, the Union of Federal Air Traffic Controllers, went on strike, violating a federal law prohibiting government unions from striking, declaring the situation an emergency as described in the 1947 Taft-Hartley Act. Reagan stated that if the air traffic controllers do not report for work within 48 hours, they have forfeited their jobs and will be terminated. They did not return, and on August 5, Reagan fired 11,345 striking air traffic controllers who had ignored his order, and used supervisors and military controllers to handle the nation's commercial air traffic until new controllers could be hired and trained. A leading reference work on public administration concluded, the firing of PATCO employees not only demonstrated a clear resolve by the president to take control of the bureaucracy, but it also sent a clear message to the private sector that unions no longer needed to be feared. Reaganomics and the Economy main article, Reaganomics. The neutrality of this article is disputed. Relevant discussion may be found on the talk page. Please do not remove this message until conditions to do so are met. March 2016. Learn how and when to remove this template message outlining his plan for tax reduction legislation from the Oval Office in a televised address. July 1981. During Jimmy Carter's last year in office 1980, inflation averaged 125%, compared with 44% during Reagan's last year in office 1988. During Reagan's administration, the unemployment rate declined from 75% to 54%, with the rate reaching highs of 108% in 1982 and 104% in 1983. Averaging 75% over the 8 years, and real GDP growth averaged 34% with a high of 86% in 1983, while nominal GDP growth averaged 74%, and peaked at 122% in 1982. Reagan implemented policies based on supply-side economics, advocating a laissez-faire philosophy and free market fiscal policy, seeking to stimulate the economy with large, across-the-board tax cuts. He also supported returning the United States to some sort of gold standard, and successfully urged Congress to establish the U.S. Gold Commission to study how one could be implemented, citing the economic theories of Arthur Laffer. Reagan promoted the proposed tax cuts as potentially stimulating the economy enough to expand the tax base, offsetting the revenue loss due to reduced rates of taxation, a theory that entered political discussion as the Laffer curve. Reaganomics was the subject of debate, with supporters pointing to improvements in certain key economic indicators as evidence of success, and critics pointing to large increases in federal budget deficits and the national debt. His policy of peace through strength resulted in a record peacetime defense buildup, including a 40% real increase in defense spending between 1981 and 1985. During Reagan's presidency, federal income tax rates were lowered significantly with the signing of the Economic Recovery Tax Act of 1981, which lowered the top marginal tax bracket from 70% to 50% and the lowest bracket from 14% to 11%. Other tax increases passed by Congress and signed by Reagan ensured, however, that tax revenues over his two terms were 182% of GDP as compared to 181% over the 40-year period of 1970 to 2010. Then, in 1982, the Job Training Partnership Act of 1982 was signed into law, initiating one of the United States' first public-private partnerships and a major part of the president's job creation program. Reagan's Assistant Secretary of Labor and Chief of Staff, Al Angrisani, was a primary architect of the bill. Conversely, Congress passed and Reagan signed into law tax increases of some nature in every year from 1981 to 1987 to continue funding such government programs as Tax Equity and Fiscal Responsibility Act of 1982 TEFRA, Social Security, and the Deficit Reduction Act of 1984 DEFRA. Despite the fact that TEFRA was the largest peacetime tax increase in American history, gross domestic product GDP growth recovered strongly after the early 1980s recession ended in 1982, and grew during his 8 years in office at an annual rate of 79% per year, with a high of 122% growth in 1981. Unemployment peaked at 108% monthly rate in December 1982, higher than any time since the Great Depression, then dropped during the rest of Reagan's presidency. 16 million new jobs were created, while inflation significantly decreased decreased the Tax Reform Act of 1986, another bipartisan effort championed by Reagan, simplified the tax code by reducing the number of tax brackets to 4 and slashing a number of tax breaks. The top rate was dropped to 28%, but capital gains taxes were increased on those with the highest incomes from 20% to 28%. The increase of the lowest tax bracket from 11% to 15% was more than offset by expansion of the personal exemption, standard deduction, and earned income tax credit. The net result was the removal of 6 million poor Americans from the income tax roll and a reduction of income tax liability at all income levels. The net effect of all Reagan-era tax bills was a 1% decrease in government revenues when compared to Treasury Department revenue estimates from the administration's first post-enactment January budgets. However, federal income tax receipts increased from 1980 to 1989, rising from $3,087 billion to $549 billion, or an average annual rate of 82%. 25% attributed to higher Social Security receipts, and federal outlays grew at an annual rate of 71%. Addressing Congress on the Program for Economic Recovery, April 28, 1981, a few weeks after surviving an assassination attempt, Reagan's policies proposed that economic growth would occur when marginal tax rates were low enough to spur investment, which would then lead to higher employment and wages. Critics labeled this trickle-down economics, the belief that tax policies that benefit the wealthy will create a trickle-down effect to the poor. Questions arose whether Reagan's policies benefited the wealthy more than those living in poverty, and many poor and minority citizens viewed Reagan as indifferent to their struggles. These views were exacerbated by the fact that Reagan's economic regimen included freezing the minimum wage at $335 an hour, slashing federal assistance to local governments by 60%, cutting the budget for public housing and Section 8 rent subsidies in half, and eliminating the anti-poverty community development block grant program. The widening gap between the rich and poor had already begun during the 1970s before Reagan's economic policies took effect. Along with Reagan's 1981 cut in the top regular tax rate on unearned income, he reduced the maximum capital gains rate to only 20%. Reagan later set tax rates on capital gains at the same level as the rates on ordinary income like salaries and wages, with both topping out at 28%. Reagan is viewed as an anti-tax hero despite raising taxes 11 times over the course of his presidency, all in the name of fiscal responsibility. According to Paul Krugman, overall, the 1982 tax increase undid about a third of the 1981 cut. As a share of GDP, the increase was substantially larger than Mr. policies partially influenced the stock market crash of 1987, but there is no consensus regarding a single source for the crash. In order to cover newly spawned federal budget deficits, the United States borrowed heavily both domestically and abroad, raising the national debt from $997. Demonstrated the means required for the United States to generate and lead the next evolutionary leap in technology acquisition and utilization for a competitive advantage, automated innovation to ensure that the United States acquired the maximum benefit from automated innovation. Reagan, during his second term, had an executive order drafted to create a new federal agency to implement the Project Socrates results on a nationwide basis. However, Reagan's term came to end before the executive order could be coordinated and signed, and the incoming Bush administration, labeling Project Socrates as industrial policy, had it terminated escalation of the Cold War. See also, Cold War 1979-85. As the first U.S. president invited to speak before the British Parliament June 8, 1982, Reagan predicted Marxism would end up on the ash heap of history. Reagan escalated the Cold War, accelerating a reversal from the policy of détente which began in 1979 after the Soviet war in Afghanistan. Reagan ordered a massive buildup of the United States Armed Forces and implemented new policies towards the Soviet Union, reviving the B-1 Lancer program that had been canceled by the Carter administration, and producing the MX missile in response to Soviet deployment of the SS-20. Reagan oversaw NATO's deployment of the Pershing missile in West Germany. In 1984, journalist Nicholas Lemann interviewed Secretary of Defense Caspar Weinberger and summarized the strategy of the Reagan administration to roll back the Soviet Union. Their society is economically weak, and it lacks the wealth, education, and technology to enter the information age. They have thrown everything into military production, and their society is starting to show terrible stress. As a result, they can't sustain military production the way we can. Eventually it will break them, and then there will be just one superpower in a safe world. If only only if, we can keep spending. LeMond notes that when he wrote that in 1984, he thought the Reaganites were living in a fantasy world, but by 2016, LeMond stated that the passage represents a fairly uncontroversial description of what Reagan actually did. Together with the United Kingdom's Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, Reagan denounced the Soviet Union in ideological terms in a famous address on June 8, 1982, to the Parliament of the United Kingdom in the Royal Gallery of the Palace of Westminster. Reagan said, "The forward march of freedom and democracy will leave Marxism-Leninism on the ash heap of history." On March 3, 1983, he predicted that communism would collapse, stating, "Communism is another sad, bizarre chapter in human history whose last pages even now are being written." In a speech to the National Association of Evangelicals on March 8, 1983, Reagan called the Soviet Union an evil empire. After Soviet fighters downed Korean Airlines Flight 007 near Manaron Island on September 1, 1983, carrying 269 people, including Georgia Congressman Larry McDonald, Reagan labeled the act a massacre and declared that the Soviets had turned against the world and the moral precepts which guide human relations among people everywhere. The Reagan administration responded to the incident by suspending all Soviet passenger air service to the United States, and dropped several agreements being negotiated with the Soviets, wounding them financially as a result of the shootdown, and the cause of Cal 07's going astray thought to be inadequacies related to its navigational system. Reagan announced on September 16, 1983, that the global positioning system would be made available for civilian use, free of charge, once completed in order to avert similar navigational errors in future meeting with leaders of the Afghan Mujahideen in the Oval Office, 1983, under a policy that came to be known as the Reagan Doctrine. Reagan and his administration also provided overt and covert aid to anti-communist resistance movements in an effort to roll back Soviet-backed communist governments in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Reagan deployed the CIA's Special Activities Division to Afghanistan and Pakistan. They were instrumental in training, equipping, and leading Mujahideen forces against the Soviet Army. President Reagan's covert action program has been given credit for assisting in ending the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan, though some of the United States-funded